What's up, guys? How you doing?
Hey, welcome. I was just doing a quick Instagram story from backstage, which is behind that banner. So you're all in my story now. Cool, what's going on? I'm Ari Herstand. Thank you for coming to my session today. This is my sixth year in a row speaking at South by, but my first year doing a solo talk. So this is kind of a big thing for me, and I appreciate you coming for this. So I'm going to just give you a brief background on who I am, what I do, where I've been, how I got to right here, and then we'll dig in. So my name is Ari Herstand. I am an independent musician. I'm based in LA. I quit my day job at Starbucks in 2008, and I've been pursuing creative endeavors ever since, mostly music and some other things. And so I actually went to a music school. Raise your hand if you went to a music school or studied music or music anything. Okay, so yeah, we got a few of those. So when I went, I actually started at the University of Minnesota as like a trumpet major, classical trumpet, music education. I realized very early on I didn't want to do that and didn't want to teach high school band. And so I transitioned over to a music industry school in Minnesota where I studied music business and songwriting. I'm a songwriter, singer-songwriter. And when I was there, now this was circa 2005. So this was kind of the height of Napster. iTunes had just started. This was like Facebook was still just college only. This was pre-YouTube. You know, MySpace was just starting to kick right then. But what I was learning at this music school was pretty much how the industry had worked up until that point. Nobody knew, definitely not the teachers at the school, what was happening or what was about to happen. But I learned everything that I thought I needed to know about how to run a successful music career. I took a class on record labels where we negotiated a 120-page recording contract. I took a class on publishing, basically all the music business stuff. But as soon as I graduated, I quickly realized that a lot of the stuff that I learned was not really applicable. Like they said, okay, there's only, you know, if you want to be a musician, this is how you do it. You have to go get signed by a label. I'm like, okay, cool. So I graduated and I was like, all right, where's my record deal? I'm ready, here I am. Like, I guess I can't start my music career unless I get a record deal because that's what I was taught in school. And my record deal wasn't coming. So I'm like, all right, well, I guess I could just sit around and wait because they told me that I have to have a deal. And I'm like, or I love music, I love playing music. Let me just get out and start doing it. So that's what I did. I started playing around shows around Minneapolis where I was living at the time. And nobody came to my show. So I'm like, okay, I wonder why no one came to my show. Well, I guess I didn't tell anybody about it. I didn't promote it. So that's maybe why. So the next show, I told people about, I promoted it, and then people started coming. I'm like, I learned a lesson, a very valuable lesson. I have to promote my shows. So then I kept doing that, and eventually I was selling out venues in a 5-state region. I was getting songs placed on TV shows. I was touring the country. I was charting on iTunes, performing on TV shows, and I was doing this all independently. As an independent musician, I didn't have a manager, I didn't have a booking agent, I was booking all my club shows, but didn't have a label. And eventually people started asking me, like, how are you doing this? And like, how did you book this tour? How did you get the song on this TV show? How did you do this? And I would respond to everybody. And then after a while, word kind of got out that if you have questions about the music business, go ask Ari. And so then I started getting flooded with messages on Facebook from people all over the country. And I would try to get back to everybody, and I just didn't have the time to respond to everyone. So I put up all the most frequently asked questions that I was getting answers to those on my blog, Ari's Take, which I had started then. And I kind of just put up everything I was learning. So if I learned something, I got screwed over by a club and a deal there, I would write about it and be like, hey, don't do this kind of a club deal, that does not work for me, and here's what you should do. And then I'm like, huh, I wonder how to get my music online, iTunes, Spotify, everything like that. So I'm like, well, there's a bunch of distributors out there, let me figure this out and start, and I did a comparison and I put that up there. And so I kind of kept this blog, just anytime I learned something, I put it up there, just as like a resource for other musicians, because I was like, well, I believe in sharing the knowledge. I believe that a rising tide lifts all ships. I don't believe in competition in the music industry. We're all kind of in this together. We're one big music family. So I'm like, if I learn something, I want everybody to know it. I don't want to hoard this information. And so I just kept sharing it. And it started to expand, and people started coming up to me saying that it was really helping them, and that Ari's take was something that they were using. I remember coming to South By 5 years ago, and I got stopped on the street by this band, and like, Ari, dude, we're on a 50-day tour right now because of your blog, because of your article that helped us book this tour. I'm like, okay, this is working, this is awesome, so I'm gonna keep it going. And then word got out, and I was approached by Digital Music News to write for them, saying, hey, we like your style, we like the tips that you're sharing, will you write for us? I'm like, okay, cool, but I'm a musician first, so they're like, don't worry about it, you can write whatever you want, whenever you want, just when you're inspired to write something, post it, here are the keys to the website. I'm like, perfect. So the best thing about this was that now I had an Ari@digitalmusicnews.com email, and I could sit down with virtually anyone in the music industry that I wanted to. So now I'm like, okay, I have access. And now, before I was just some indie artist with a blog, and now I write for a major music publication, and so I was starting, I went full steam ahead and started calling everybody up, Spotify, Apple, record labels, booking agents, and just sitting down with them and trying to ask them the questions that all musicians have, but we don't really have the access to ask those people. So anytime I would sit down with people, I would go in and like, okay, I'm a musician, like, how does this happen? How do you do this? How do you do this? And so then I started writing about all of that. And as an independent musician, kind of learning all of this stuff, Forbes came out with a piece that they called me the poster child of DIY music. Now, it's a little misnomer, DIY standing for do it yourself. I didn't do anything all myself. And I think that that's a really important distinction because nobody can do everything all by themselves. I didn't have a traditional team. I didn't have a manager or a booking agent or a label or really an attorney on a retainer or anything like that, which is like what Donald Passman would tell you in his book is the team that you need. I didn't have that team. But I had people who were on my team who were really into what I was doing and willing to help. Street teams, I had friends who were helping out, who would go out postering with me, or help me with social media, or all the different things. And so when people say, I'm a DIY musician, that's great, but don't feel like you need to do everything yourself, because that's impossible. Enlist help of your friends, and you don't need help of the industry, at least not yet. You can do so much on your own and build up your career to a level that is sustainable, that will get the industry to take notice without actual quote-unquote industry people. You just bring in your friends, just bring in people who are down for what you're doing, and that's your team. That's a great team to have. That's the team that you want. I would much prefer a friend who is diehard and willing to kick ass with me, but has no industry credentials, than a big time, very important manager at some huge company that doesn't really give a shit about me, but I can like be on the roster or something because they're not gonna work for me. I'd much rather have the person who's gonna really kick ass. And yeah, they might have to make 20 more phone calls than the big time manager, but at least they'd give a shit. And that's what you want. You only wanna bring people on your team who give a shit. So anyway, after all of this, I got approached to come out with a book on everything that I was learning. And I wanted to write this book because I was hearing all of these stories from independent musicians all over the world that were making it work in a really interesting way that was totally different from what the industry was talking about. And nobody was telling these stories. And that kind of drove me nuts. Like Billboard wasn't talking about how all these indie artists are killing it on Patreon or how they're selling out their tour dates at 500 cap venues. All they were writing about was how many records Adele sold or Taylor Swift sold. And I'm like, I don't care about that. And no other indie musician I know cares about that. They want to know, how can we book a successful tour? How can we get more Spotify streams? How can we build up fans? How do we engage them? How do we use Instagram to get a fan base? Like, that's the stuff we care about. And no one was writing about this. So I'm like, okay, these stories are happening. I was talking to literally hundreds of people who were telling me that they were making a music career happen in a really interesting, different way, and the industry was ignoring them. And so that's one of the reasons for the book, is I wanted to tell those stories, but also show to musicians how you can make it happen and make a career work. So before we kind of really dig in, we have to step back and understand what success looks like in the new music business. So we all understand kind of conceptually what the old music business is. In the old music business, there was one way to make it work. It's what I was taught in school. You get signed to a record deal, you get on the radio, you go on tour. That was it. Well, that was success in the old music business. And there was that's how you did it, and what success, how success was defined in the old music business was sell a boatload of records. That's it. Sell a million records, successful. You sell 25,000, failure. That was it. That's all how they measured success in the old music business. New music business is very different. The new music business is, there isn't just one way to make it happen. There are 100 ways to make a career happen in the new music business. And success in the new music business is extremely personal. No one can define success for you. Don't allow people to throw their metrics at you and say, oh, you only have 10,000 followers on Instagram? You must be a failure. I know people with 100,000 followers on Instagram and they have day jobs. And I know musicians with 15,000 followers on Instagram that are selling out every venue on their tour. These social metrics that we're looking at right now, they're tricky. They trick people. They fool people. We all know that numbers can be gained and you can buy followers and all of that stuff. The real core and the root of it is that you have to figure out what success looks like for you. I can't tell you what success looks like for you because it's personal. Some people's success is, I want to be able to play shows around my hometown, maybe do a couple weekend shows, and make enough money to support my family doing what I love. That's it. Okay. There's nothing wrong with that. That's great. Some people are like, you know what, I want to tour the country, and I really want to play theaters, and I want to do that thing. Cool, that's success for you. Other people are like, you know what, I don't want to play live. I don't like playing live. I just want to make music for my studio and put that music out and sustain a lifestyle doing that. Fine, that's totally cool too. No one can define it for you. For me, success looks like doing what I love, supporting the kind of lifestyle that I want, and doing what I love, supporting the kind of lifestyle that I want. That's success for me. That's it. I mean, I don't use metrics to define success for me. It's just, am I happy? Can I sustain the kind of life that I want to live? Do I love what I'm doing? Success. That's it. So now, get asked a lot about fame. Because fame naturally is a component for some music careers. Fame should never be a driving force of why you're in music. If you are in music to become famous, you should quit right now. Because there are a lot easier ways to get famous. Go make a sex tape, something. Just, music is not the way that you want to become famous. Fame should be looked at as an occupational hazard to a music career, not the goal. That being said, in the new music business, there are a lot of independent musicians that have reached those stratospheric levels of success. And absolutely, they're reaching that without the help of a label. We all know about Chance the Rapper. He was one of the first to really break on that huge, huge stratospheric level of success. 1 billion streams. Number 7 on the Forbes 30 Under 30. The first unsigned artist to play Saturday Night Live. The first unsigned artist to win the Grammy for Best New Artist. No label. He broke all the records. He charted on the Billboard 200 for the first streaming-only record. He was one of the first. But while this was happening, and then Billboard started taking notice. They're like, whoa, okay, unsigned artists are actually doing something. I was hearing about all these other stories. Lau is another artist recently in the last couple years. Also 1 billion streams. Charted in the Billboard Hot 100, Billboard 200, certified platinum, performed The Tonight Show. No label. Ingrid Michaelson, one of the first actually to define really huge success without a record label. also cracked Billboard Hot 100, certified platinum. She currently has 2 million monthly listeners, 200 million streams. I saw her when she sold out the Greek Theater in LA. You probably have heard of her when she was kind of the sync licensing queen. She got all of her music placed on Grey's Anatomy and the Old Navy commercial back in the day. This was like 08, 09, when she was starting to break out because of sync licensing, because getting her music placed on TV shows and commercials and movies. No label. Ron Pope, singer-songwriter based out of Nashville now, also 1 billion streams. That's a lot of streams, 1 billion streams. Also 2 million monthly listeners, sells at venues around the world, no label. Wolfpack, funk band, splits their time between Ann Arbor, Michigan and LA. I saw them when they sold out Red Rocks last year. They're playing Madison Square Garden this year. They played The Late Show with Stephen Colbert, 1 million monthly listeners, and one of the coolest metrics is for their latest album, their pre-order campaign, which wasn't actually done through Kickstarter or Pledge Music. Luckily not Pledge Music, I don't know if any of you are caught in that shitstorm that's happening right now, we'll talk about that later. They did it on their own. They created their own little pre-order campaign and they made $200,000 from 7,000 fans for their pre-order. These guys, they're killing it. Lucidius, hip-hop artist. 500,000 monthly Spotify listeners, 100 million streams, 250,000 Facebook likes. He's making about 20 grand a month just from streaming revenue, 100,000 Instagram followers, no label. Dodie, she kind of broke out, one of the most recent YouTube stars. I know YouTubers were kind of a big thing in 2011, not so much today, but she broke out in the last couple years from YouTube. She tours the country, tours the world actually, she's from the UK, killing it as well, selling out all of her shows. Postmodern Jukebox, another YouTube band. They broke out right around that time, kind of 2011, 2012. I'm sure you've seen their videos. They're like these, they do 20s jazz renditions of pop songs, and they bring in singers, different singers and players and everything like that. What's cool about them, so the guy in front, Scott Bradley, he's kind of the mastermind behind it. And he has simultaneous casts. He doesn't even have to perform with the band. He just sends out a bunch of musicians under the Postmodern Jukebox name, and they go all over the world playing theater simultaneously. That's a cash cow. That's insane. And that's really working for them. Also, 1 billion views. Okay. So I hope by now you just have some small examples of you can actually have a real successful music career without signing to a major record label. None of those artists are signed to major record labels. But those are the stratospheric levels of success. Like I said, there are thousands of independent musicians right now that are making 5, 6, 7 figure incomes doing music on their own, but we don't hear about them because they're not Taylor Swift or Adele and Billboard's not talking about them, so they're not part of the conversation. But what's one of the craziest statistics that you'll ever hear, and I hope you share this with all your friends, over 98% of artists that actually get signed to a major label fail. Meaning, if a major label signs 100 acts this year, 98 of them are not going to recoup the cost of their advance, and they're gonna get dropped before their second album. So you actually have a better chance of real sustained lifelong success not signing to a major label. Now that being said, and I don't want to shit on major labels because it's just the business model is different. So if we have any people in the room that work for major labels, don't come after me after this presentation. Let me just explain this. They'll be the first to admit this stat. But the thing is, it's that it's not necessary. That's the thing. Major label, signing to a major is not necessary anymore. It can be part of the game plan if you want it to be at a certain level. But the thing is with major labels is they used to take artists from here to here. Now, they're only taking artists from here to here, and maybe they get them to here. But so how do you get from here to here now? Because labels aren't looking at these artists anymore. They're not scouting in local bars on Sunset like they used to do. It's all about the numbers for them. They need something that's already happening. They need real fans. Who's got the fans? Who's built it up? So how do you get to that point? That is what an independent music career looks like today, and that's what I've been trying to share with people. It's like, oh, here's how you can get yourself to this point. And then, when you're at that point, you can decide if signing with a label is right for you or not. And you make that decision. But when you're at this point, you then have the clout to dictate the terms of your agreement. And hopefully every label will become begging to work with you, pounding down your door, saying, please, please come sign with us. And you say, okay, cool. Well, I want this, 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 and this, and I'm not budging on that. So take it or leave it. That's what you want to do. You don't want to be like, please, can I get a record deal? Please, please, come on. Be like, sure, here's $5,000 and give us your firstborn baby. Yeah, cool. Okay, fine, thank you, I have a record deal, yay. And then all your parents will give you, you know, your friends and family will give you a pat on the back, you got a major record deal, oh, you must be successful. And then you realize like 2 years later that that was probably not the best decision. So make sure you build up your career to here first, and then you can decide if working with a label is right for you. The president of Universal Republic, one of the biggest major record labels in the world, said, don't try to get signed, try to become popular first. And this was in response to a question, hey, how do I get a record deal, Mr. Lippman? Hey, I want a record deal. And he's the president of Universal Republic. He's like, yeah, don't try to get signed. No. Get yourself to here first. That's what they're looking at. Don't let labels fool you in that they do artist development anymore. Back in the day, they did. Bruce Springsteen's first two albums flopped. Flopped. They didn't sell anything, but they stuck, Columbia Records stuck it out with him in the late 70s because they believed in him as an artist. Like, you know what, that's okay. We love your music, let's keep this going. We're building something. And then record three, Born to Run, massive success. They don't do that anymore. They're not sticking with you through two failed records. They won't stick you through two failed singles. If your two singles don't get like 50 million streams, you're a failure. You're done. Dropped. That's where we're at right now. Okay. So one of the biggest questions that I get asked, especially because I do so much now, is how do I manage my time? How do you manage your time as a musician? Because now we've established you have to have that entrepreneurial mindset, spirit. And if you don't have that, you need people on your team who do have that. So, like I said, team before, team can look like anything. Just bring people on who are into what you're doing, and then you can delegate. You can say, okay, I know what needs to get done, but I can't do all this. Or I'm not good at this, and you're really good at this. Like, okay, I'm really shitty at graphic design. You're awesome at graphic design. Can you help me design some things? Great, now they're on your team. And I'm not good at video editing, but you're awesome at video editing. Can you help me with this? Okay, cool. The 50-50 rule, this is my rule for how to manage your time and your money. 50% of your time should be spent on your art, the creation of that art. And 50% of your time should be spent on the business, the promotion of that art. Now, this isn't an everyday equation. This is not like 1 p.m., your alarm goes off, it's like, well, time to switch to the business. That's not possible. I like to think that I have a very balanced brain with like, you know, left side, right side, and they come in and out of play as an artist and business person, they go up and down. I can't do that. This is over the course of your career. So when you're working on your record, you're in the writing, recording stage, 85, 90% of your time is going to be spent on the art, as it should. That's your time to focus on your art. You absolutely shouldn't be spending the majority of your time. You'll still be sending some emails, doing some social stuff, whatever. But then when it comes time to release that record, that's when it flips. Then it's 85% of your time is spent on promoting that art, on the business side, and you need to spend that time. But this isn't just for time. This also deals with your money. 50% of your money needs to be invested into the creation of that art. But also, 50% of that money needs to be invested in the promotion of that art. If you don't leave any money left over to promote your music, it doesn't matter how good your record sounds, because it's not, no one's gonna hear it. There's so much music released, it's gonna get lost in the noise. Doesn't matter how brilliant your music is. And I know I'm saying this right now, and 90% of you are going to go back and say, we gotta record a new record, and let's run a Kickstarter for it. Okay, cool, how much do we need to raise? Well, we got the quotes from the producer and the studio and the players and everything, the mixing engineer, mastering, it's gonna cost at least $10,000 for this record, but can we do $10,000 Kickstarter? I don't know, let's try it. All right, let's raise $10,000. Then you raise $10,000, your record actually costs $12,000, and it's time to release the record, and you have $27 left over to promote it. And then you're gonna wonder, why is no one caring about my music? Why can't I get anyone to listen to my music? I posted about it 37 times yesterday on Facebook and Instagram. What the hell? So you need money. If your record is gonna cost $10,000 to make, you need to raise $20,000 on Kickstarter. And if you can't do that, then don't make a full record. Why do you need a full album these days? Unless you have something to say that's gonna take over a full record, you don't need to make a full album these days. I know, we're all musicians, I'm a musician, I feel you. Yes, our favorite artists that we grew up on released albums, but that's because the format at the time was vinyl records or CDs, and that was the format of how you distributed the music. The format has changed. Do you know why the Pink Floyd's Dark Side of the Moon album is 44 minutes long? You know, the generation-defining Dark Side of the Moon is 44 minutes long. Why? That's not because their generation-defining masterpiece of this music was meant to be 44 minutes. So like, you know, we've said all that we can say, this is it, exactly 44 minutes, this is what we wanted it to be. It's because a vinyl record could only hold 22 minutes of music per side. And so and that's why there's silence in between track 5 and 6, because you had to flip the record over. That was the format at the time. Now we're seeing artists release songs with 25 songs on them. We're seeing hour and a half long albums, which don't fit on CDs or records. Yes, albums got longer when CDs came out, because it wasn't just 44 minutes anymore, it was now 70 minutes. You could fit 70 minutes of music on a CD. So when you're thinking about making an album, you have to think about, why am I making an album? What's the purpose? Do I have something to say over the whole album? Is this a conceptual record? Okay, that's your art, I respect that. But if it's just like, I just gotta throw 10 songs together so I can say I have an album, that's not a good reason for me. No one's gonna care about that. Just release singles. We're in a singles economy right now. Everyone's listening to your music on Apple Music or Spotify anyways. So you don't need a full album. Unless you're playing a lot of shows and you need to sell CDs and people are still buying your CDs, great, that's cool. I respect that too. What is the reason that you're making an album? Always ask yourself that. Okay. Now when people come to me and they're like, Ari, what do I do? I am a musician, I'm struggling to kind of get traction. How do I get traction? What do I do? I say, I have no idea. Because I don't know you. I don't know what kind of music you're into. I don't know what kind of career you want to have. I don't know what success looks like for you. This is all totally personal. So I'm like, what you can do and what everybody in here can do, and I encourage everyone to do this. If you have not done this yet, absolutely do this tomorrow or Monday when you get back home. Set goals, specific goals. What do you want to have happen in 6 months from now? Sounds obvious, but it's definitely not. Because again, there's no one way to do it. And here's the thing. So many people say, yeah, I tried that. Hey, turn your phone off. I tried that. And it didn't work for me. Like, did you really try that? What do you mean? Like, yeah, I tried it, I did a little bit of this, and it didn't work, so I tried something else. And then I tried this and did a little bit of this, and that didn't work. And so I tried this and it, I'm like, okay, that's because you have no idea what you're trying to do. You haven't set goals. If you set a goal of, let's use an example, in 6 months, I want to get at least one song placed on a TV show. Solid goal. Okay. Now that's the goal. That's a concrete goal. Now you can reverse engineer that goal. Okay, how am I going to get to that goal? Well, TV shows. All right. Well, will any TV show work? No, because if you make acoustic music, Empire is not the home for your music. They're not playing your kind of music. Similarly, if you make hip hop, Grey's Anatomy is not the show for you. So why would you waste your time sending your music to the TV shows that aren't gonna ever play your music? It's actually disrespectful and insulting to those music supervisors if you send them a hip hop track for Grey's Anatomy or a song, because they're like, so you don't care enough about what I do, my art, which is curating music for this TV show, to even watch one episode or look at the music. You could spend 2 minutes researching the music on each TV show, 2 minutes on the TV show that you're looking to submit to, and realize, oh, none of these artists are like me. So why would I waste my time with those shows? This is part of the research that you need to do. So when you say, well, I sent emails to music supervisors that didn't work, like, okay, but how did you do it? It's all in the how. It's not just the what. So you find this is the process of reverse engineering. Okay, so now I've figured out which TV shows my music would work on. Okay, so who places music in these TV shows? Okay, music supervisors. Who are the music supervisors for those TV shows? Oh, okay, let me find those out. Oh, I found them. What's their email? What's their Twitter? What's their Instagram? Okay, found that out. Now, oh, they say they don't want to be contacted by me. Okay, they don't take anything unsolicited. All right, they don't want to talk to independent musicians. Okay, some music supervisors will, some music supervisors will not. Last week, I spoke to music supervisors. There were 6 of them I was talking to. 3 of them said, I love it when independent artists send me music. It's really exciting, and I love developing that relationship. The other 3 are like, I won't even open the email from someone I don't know. There's no catch-all with this. So you find the ones that will accept your music and you can hit them up. But how do you hit them up? What do they want to see in an email? All of this stuff is the research that goes into the goal that you set. So see all that stuff that I just talked about for the one goal of getting a song placed on a TV show? I only scratched the surface. Okay, so for those that don't accept music from indie artists, how do they accept music? From sync licensing companies? Okay, so I should get a sync licensing company. What's a sync licensing company? Where do I find those? What kind of artists do they have? This is all the research that you need to do to get in the door and to get your music heard and then placed for that goal, if that's your goal. But your goal could be something else. Okay, I want 100,000 streams on Spotify in 6 months. Very obtainable. How do you do it? Same kind of reverse engineering. You look into how is that going to be possible. Set specific goals. 6 months, 1 year, 5 years. And then you know you can work towards those. Why they need to be specific? Very specific. Because you need to visualize it. You need to see it. You actually need to see it happen. If you see that TV show, you know what TV show your music would work well on. I want you to do an exercise with yourself where you close your eyes and in your mind, you hear your song on that show. That is visualizing it. The only way you can make something happen is by visualizing it first, and then you manifest it. You make it happen. It doesn't just happen. But that's step one, is you have to believe it will happen. That's visualizing it. Every goal you set, visualize first. Okay, changing gears a little bit. Now we're getting into the more real specific stuff, real nitty gritty. The disconnect between musician and blogger. Oh, and by the way, at the end, if you want these slides that I've been going through, you can shoot an email to slides@aristake.com and I'll just email you all the slides. I'll have it up on the board at the very end. So don't worry about, I see a lot of you taking photos of every slide. Don't worry about that. I'll just send you all the slides. Okay. I like to look at bloggers as kind of like personifying the general music public. So blogs aren't as powerful today as they were 5 years ago. 5 years ago, blogs were used as discovery. Now, Spotify Discover Weekly is used as discovery. And that's okay, but blogs are still important in helping you tell your story. They help communicate what you're doing to the masses. So when people discover your music, and they hear about it, bless you, they will go online and Google you, and then articles will come up, and they'll read about you. They help tell your story. But here's the thing, most musicians don't know how to communicate their story. They don't know what their story is. They don't know how to talk to bloggers. They don't know how to talk to anyone. When they come up to them and they say, yeah, you gotta check out this new band. Oh, okay, why? Oh, well, they're good. Why? They're good. No, that's not how anybody tells their friends about music. Like, oh, well, you know, they, you gotta check them out. Yeah, they came from this place and they actually got in a car accident. They were thrown from the van and, you know, three of them broke their legs. They were in a hospital. And while in the hospital, they wrote this record. This record's dope. You gotta check it out. That's a story. It's like, oh, okay, yeah. And you listen to it, it's like, yeah, wow, that's totally crazy. Okay, cool. This gonna be, so I wanna do a little exercise here, because I wanna show the disconnect between musicians and bloggers and just show it. So I need a volunteer, someone who's a musician, who's an active working musician, and they wanna volunteer, just do a listening exercise with me. This is not challenging. I'm just gonna play a song and you're gonna tell me what you hear. There's no wrong answer. You wanna do it? Okay, right here in front. Cool. Yeah, and the notepad too. I'll give you the. You have one? Either way. Okay, cool. What's your name?
My name's Colin.
Colin?
Yes, sir.
All right, where are you from?
I'm from down the street in San Marcos. I'm a sound recording student.
All right, very cool. Sound recording student. Oh, so you have really good ears. Yeah. Okay, are you a musician also?
Yes, sir.
What do you play?
I'm at school for French horn, but I play guitar and bass and mandolin.
Ah, fellow brass. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, there you go. Very cool. So I'm gonna play a piece of music, and I want you to write down everything you hear.
Okay.
Just tell me, and just write down what you hear.
So, I mean, I don't know if you cut it, but it faded in. I really like that. You know, I could hear bells at first, the cowbells. I really like that.
Cowbells, cool.
You know, there was lots of tom fills, so there was a bunch of energy immediately bursting through.
Cool.
The percussion was nice and spaced. It was very stereophonic. I like that. I don't know if it was drummer perspective or audience perspective. It was very nice. Very snappy.
True audio engineer, the stereophonic. Yeah. Was it from the drummer perspective with the floor?
Well, it was, because the hat was very snappy. It was on the left.
Drummer perspective.
I loved it.
Yeah, right. Okay, cool.
No, if I'm listening to something, I immediately notice that. Yeah. It immediately catches me. It's okay, did this person know what they're doing?
Good ears. Okay, cool. So you're not a percussionist.
No, I'm not, but I love. Yeah.
You're like Janata. Awesome. Keep going. It's great.
It's very grooving. you know, I couldn't tell if it was brass at first, and I was like, okay, this is definitely horns. I really like that. I love that music. Grew up with Earth, Wind & Fire. I love it. Suddenly there were fiddles out of nowhere.
Yeah.
I love that. And suddenly, like, because, you know, you listen to those tiny things, and it catches you, and you're like, oh, what was that?
Yeah.
And the vocals were very forward and clear. They're definitely the focus in the music was the vocals.
Mm-hmm.
And that sometimes, you know, performances don't want that, or they want something really dreamy and spread and smeary, but the vocals were very tight and clear.
Tight and clear vocals.
That's all I got.
Great. Let's give him a hand. That was great. That was really good. Thanks. Awesome. I'm sure a lot of you, raise your hand if you're a musician in the room, just so I can get an idea. Okay. Awesome. Raise your hand if you are, do we have any bloggers in the room? Couple. Okay, cool. Me being one too. Managers. Awesome. Good to see you. Agents. One. Hey, what's up? Welcome. Anyone from major labels? Nope. We're in the clear, okay. They're not gonna admit it anyways. Okay. Colin, absolutely. I'm sure all the musicians and even people who are music lovers and aficionados in here, that's what you heard too. A lot of those things, and I'm sure we picked out other moments. That's what musicians hear, absolutely. Stereophonics. you wanna know what bloggers hear when they hear that exact same piece of music? They hear this. And they hear that, or they hear this, or they hear that, or they hear, whereas musicians, when we hear that piece of music, we see this. There's your fiddle. Your percussion over your drummer. Bloggers hear that. So sorry about that. That's a great idea, my friend. All right. There we go. Ruined my week. What the hell? How is there such a disconnect between what bloggers / the general population hear and what musicians hear? It's because bloggers in the general population, just like I mentioned before, it's not about the stereophonics, and it's not about where the hi-hat is placed in the mix, and it's not about the crisp and clear forefront vocals, or how the toms were spread out, or the cowbell was happening there. This is what musicians get off to. This is what we listen to and what excites us in studio. Oh, can we pan that cowbell further to the left and put it further in the back? Yeah, wash it out. Let's get some more verb on that. Can you compress it a little bit? Yeah, that's cool. Okay, do we have a Neumann on that, or is that blue mic? No, let's switch out the Neumann. That would be really good. No one outside of a music studio is talking about that stuff, all right? Bloggers and the general population care about what the story is. So if you ignore that when you're trying to find your audience, they're gonna ignore you. When you wonder why you can't get anybody to listen to your music, 9 times out of 10, it's not about the quality of your music. It's because they don't have a story to latch onto. They don't know why they should care about you. Hey, dude, you gotta listen to this new band. Yeah, why? They're good, and the hi-hat's placed on the left side of the mix. Oh, cool. Yeah, I give it a listen. No, but they use all Neumann mics. Sweet. That's impressive or not good. What do I feel with Neumann? I don't know. So what is the story? What does that even mean? Oh, it's this brother-sister duo. Yeah, they wear red and white and the sister kills it on the drums. It's insane show. White Stripes. Oh, it's this dude, he wears this bucket on his head, it's Marshmallow, and nobody knows who he is. It's this like mysterious character, and we don't even know if it's one guy or a bunch of guys, and sometimes he does multiple shows at night. I don't know if it's the same guy, but no one knows who he is. Marshmallow. this guy went to the northern woods of Wisconsin in the wintertime in a cabin by himself and recorded this record. Listen to it. Oh yeah. Sounds like the northern woods of Wisconsin in the wintertime in a cabin by himself. Oh, it's beautiful. Only there. Oh yeah, she went up and down music row in Nashville with Cookies and her mom, and they went and distributed Cookies to all the music publishers, and that's how she got her pub deal and her record deal. It's like she just won them over with Cookies. Okay. These are the stories that people tell initially when they're sharing about the band, and what the blogs are telling and what articles are being written about. They tell the story. Now, of course, your story can evolve. Taylor Swift's story is not still that. People aren't still saying she went up and down Music Row. They're saying, oh, she took on Apple Music, and she got Apple Music to pay for the first 3 months of their of Apple Music trial period, where they weren't going to do it, and they did an about face. Okay. Bon Iver's story isn't about his first album anymore. It's evolved. He's won a Grammy now. His shows are incredible. They're extremely robust. He's got 15 people on stage now with him. It's not just him. Now, the story is the one thing that people are going to latch onto. And you have to come up with that. And you have to communicate that. That's in your press release. That's in your interviews. That's on your bio. That's the one thing that people are going to latch onto. Because, okay, Bon Iver, Justin Vernon, I know that he was in 7 bands before Bon Iver. He's from Eau Claire, Wisconsin, an hour and a half away from Minneapolis, where I lived for many years. I knew the people who were in his bands. Oh yeah, he was in all these bands. Now, if his story, in his first Pitchfork article, you can go back and reference it, was not, oh, Justin Vernon started playing guitar at a young age, and then he formed a band when he was 15 and with his girlfriend at the time, and then they broke up, but then they formed another band at 17, and they actually toured to Chicago this one time, but then they broke up, and then at 19, he formed this other band. It was a rock band. It was kind of mixed between rock, but they were experimenting with these sounds, and then, you know, they broke up again, but then he formed this other band, and they toured around a little. That's not interesting. Who cares? That's everybody's story. Okay, you play music, you're in and out of bands, you release records that nobody gives a shit about. That's everybody's story. That's not unique. But I know some of you, if I were to go on your websites right now and read your bio, I bet I could find that exact story of how many previous bands you've been in, how many records you release, and it's gonna be 12 paragraphs of stuff nobody cares about. What is the one thing that you're going to communicate that everybody's going to latch onto? And then you can have, I'll encourage you to have a short bio. Quick, to the point. What's that hook? I call it a hook. We all know hooks in songs, the things that people remember. What's your hook in your bio? What's your story? Quick. And then you have a long bio. That's for your fans. For people who are wanting to really dig into who you are and get to know you on a deep level, they'll read your long bio. What's your hook? And it's not just about your story, it's also about your aesthetic. Now, aesthetic is not just image. Image is part of aesthetic. Your aesthetic is everything to do with the vibe, the visual vibe of your project. And they all need to be tied together. Your story, that hook needs to feel like your music sounds. Like you feel like when you listen to the music. So when you pop on headphones and you listen to the record, that should feel the same as when I go see your show. And that feeling when you're live on stage, that's the same feeling. Or when I am on your Instagram, that's part of your aesthetic. That feeling should be the same. It can't be disjointed. If you play folk music, but you dress up like Kiss when you go and play your shows, that's the only thing people are going to be talking about. They're not going to talk about the lyrics in verse 3, okay? The only thing they're going to talk about is how you dressed up like Gene Simmons, and it was kind of creepy because you're playing beautiful folk music kind of thing. I don't even remember what he was playing because all I could stare at was his tongue. So, your aesthetic is very important, and it's not just what you look like, and it's not just what you wear. It's everything. It's the whole world that you create. You are an artist and you are creating an artist world, and you're inviting people into that world. Everything needs to be filtered through your artist lens. Your music, obviously, your shows, what you wear, what your Instagram looks like, your bio, all of that is filtered through the artist lens. You need to be the artist when you're creating every part of your project. Now, we're all complex human beings. We're all people. We have 1,000 stories. We have 1,000 loves and interests. You don't need to share all of those with the world because that's confusing. Because if I hear one of your songs on a playlist and I'm like, oh, I wanna go check out who this is, and I go to your Instagram and it's photos of your best friends and what you had for dinner last night, and it's inside jokes, and or God forbid it's private, your Instagram's private, or like, I'm like, okay, I don't understand what this is right now. Like, okay, let me go to the website, let me read their bio. And it's 15 paragraphs of all the previous bands you've been in. Like, okay, I don't really get that either. I'm overwhelmed with information and I just don't understand. You're trying to communicate 10 layers deep to these people when they're just trying to scratch the surface saying, is this something that I could potentially get involved in? Is their mission aligned with my mission? Can I be part of their world? Are they inviting me into their world? Or are they saying, actually, this world is just for me and my 4 best friends and all you guys can fuck off? So are you inviting your audience into your world? And you do that by communicating your artist message through your bio, through your visuals, through everything. The milk carton kids are a great example of this, because a lot of people come to me like, well, that sounds manufactured, inauthentic. I'm just an authentic artist. Okay, but you need to tell your story. Every music journalist I've spoken to, every publicist I've spoken to, they don't talk about, when I'm asking them advice on how do you get press, they don't say you have to have good music. That's a given. Of course you have to have good music. You don't even need to say that anymore. They say you need to tell us what the most interesting aspect of your project is. You need to tell us the story. You need to come up with a cool story. These guys, the Milk Carton Kids, raise your hand if you've heard of the Milk Carton Kids. Okay, a few of you. Yeah, folk Americana group. They are very traditional, Simon and Garfunkel. One of their first, now they're touring 2,000 to 3,000 seated theaters everywhere they go. One of their first tours ever, they opened my Midwest tour years back, and they were just Joey and Kenneth. They didn't have the Milk Carton Kids name yet, but they were just testing out this new thing. They were wearing what, you know, they wore as singer-songwriters. Jeans, button-downs occasionally, t-shirts, they didn't know. And they were testing out this whole new thing. And they were feeling that, like, you know, this isn't really falling into place. What is the entire aesthetic and the vision of this project? They're like, who are we targeting? What do we want people to latch onto? And how do we want people to take in our music? Oh, well, it's proper. It's up at that level. So what if we wear suits at every show and in our photo shoots? And that became their aesthetic and that became their image for the first 5, 6, 7 years of their project, is Milk Carton Kids would always show up wearing suits. Now we could have examples of in every genre, all of that. It's important to think about that, creating your aesthetic. Now how to do this specifically? I like to create what I call vibe boards. Raise your hand if you've been on Pinterest. Yeah, not many of you. I hadn't either until I started doing this. Pinterest is a great tool for you to use. You can make all your boards private. It's basically you grab any image that is inspiring, but really that feels the same way that your project feels. Remember how I talked about feeling before? Your music needs to feel like your live show, needs to feel like your aesthetic, feels like your bio. Put every image on this board that feels like your project. Doesn't need to be photos of just musicians, it can be. It can also be photos of landscapes, sunsets, models. It can be paintings, color palettes, whatever, fire. Just put images that feel like it, and then you have other boards. Then you have a breakout board that's based on the vibe board, and it's your photo board. So when you wanna do a photo shoot, the worst thing you can do is call up a great photographer and say, hey, we want to do a photo shoot for our new band, and we trust you. Just do what you like with us. No, don't ever do that. Don't ever go to a photographer and say, hey, can we do a photo shoot? yeah, what do you think? Just do whatever you want. They don't know your vision. They don't know what you're trying to communicate to the world as an artist. So why would you leave the fate of your visual representation up to this random photographer? What you're gonna get then is the photographer gonna be like, oh, okay, cool. Actually, there's this spot underneath this bridge and there's a brick wall there that I like to shoot bands in front of, so we'll just go shoot in front of that brick wall. Is that cool? Well, yes, I don't know. Yeah, yeah. Or actually, you know what? I've been wanting to test this thing out where I'm gonna like just throw paint at you. You're gonna stand up against that wall and I'm gonna just shoot it as I like chuck paint at you. Is that cool? I guess, I don't know. Yeah, cool, cool. Because I've always wanted to try that out with musicians. So sweet, sweet. Let's do that. Does that represent your project? Probably not, but that was the photographer's vision as the photographer, the artist. You have to then, you can create a vibe board and then an offshoot of a photo board. And then the photography is part of that board. And then you send this board, that's all now, the photo board is different from the vibe board. The photo board is all photos of people. And then you send that photo board to the photographer. It's like, hey, we want to do a photo shoot like this. And then they'll look at this photo board like, oh, got it. I know what you're trying to communicate. I know what your image and aesthetic is, and I know what the vibe of your project is based on these photos. Okay, breaking forward. I know half of you are here because I mentioned Spotify in the description of this session. Because that's hot right now. And I see a dude with an Apple Music shirt in the back. Do you work for Apple Music? I'm putting you on the spot. That's all right.
Well, no comment.
Okay, no comment. Don't worry. We're going to talk about Apple Music too. So here's the thing with Spotify. There are ways to grow your music, your stuff on Spotify. And we're going to dig into that. Everybody knows about playlists. Yes, sure, that's one way to grow. But we are too obsessed with playlists right now. That is not a real way to grow a fan base right now. You can get a lot of streams from a lot of listeners in a very short amount of time if you get added to a really hot playlist. But guess what? I have heard of people who get added to, I've heard of people that get added to playlists and they get hundreds of thousands of streams, millions of streams a month that got added to a really big hot Spotify playlist. And they're making all this money, making thousands of dollars a month. And then they get dropped from those playlists after they'd already quit their day job. And now their streams drop down to virtually zero. And their income drops down to virtually zero. And so then they have to go back to their boss, their old boss of their day job, and beg for their job back because they have no money. So let me lay out the playlists. But keep that in mind, that this is not the bulk of what I'm about to talk about, is how to crack Spotify playlists, because those are fickle. There's official created by Spotify playlists, there's algorithmic playlists, and there's user-generated playlists. We all know about official created by Spotify playlists, or the ones that say created by Spotify. Those are very difficult to get at. Then there's the algorithmic playlists. So here's the created by Spotify, we know those. Your favorite coffee house, get turned, usually millions of followers, bunch of those, thousands. The algorithmic playlists are like Discover Weekly. These are customized. These are not created by humans. These are playlists that are algorithmic driven. So customized per person. Every week you get a new Discover Weekly playlist of just songs that they think you're going to like that you haven't heard before. Release Radar. All the artists that you follow on Spotify, every week, here's all the new songs that has been released. Algorithmic playlist. And then user-generated playlists. This is one that I've created. Low volume funk. It's anyone can create a playlist. You can create a playlist, I created a playlist, and you can get followers to that playlist. And they can drive serious traffic and streams and followers. But there are three myths of Spotify. Number one, that streams equal fans. That is a huge myth. Just because somebody has 10 million streams right there on the homepage of their Spotify profile, does not mean they have 10 million fans. Probably means they got included on a couple big hot Spotify playlists. And they don't have many fans at all, but they got a lot of streams. Myth number two, monthly listeners equals fans. Because they're like, okay, they got a bunch of streams, but let me look at their monthly listener number right there. Oh, they got 500,000 monthly listeners. I bet they have 500,000 fans. Those are fans, right? No, it's not. How you can test this, and this is my favorite thing to do, open Spotify on your computer, not right now, not your phone, because this is only displayed on the desktop version. You go to the About section, you scroll all the way to the bottom, it says monthly listeners, and it says followers. That ratio should be at least 5%. Guaranteed, all your friends' bands that you're envious of because they got included on big hot Spotify playlists and now they're getting hundreds of thousands of streams a month, guaranteed their followers numbers down there is not at that 5% mark. You might have more followers than them. You want followers because followers are one step shy of them becoming fans. That's somebody you say, you know what, I like this. I think I want to follow this. Not a fan yet, but I could potentially be one day. The monthly listeners number is just how many people have listened to your music, most likely from a playlist. Myth number three, you need to get on playlists to get lots of streams and listeners. Incorrect. You don't need to be on any playlists. As a music industry right now, we are obsessed with Spotify and Spotify playlists. We should not be. Yes, Spotify is a very powerful tool, and I love Spotify. But, and I love their playlists. Personally, as a user, as a fan, as a listener, love their playlists, love it. But as an artist and someone in the industry, you can't bet the horse on getting on playlists. That's the conversation of everyone is like, how do I get on more playlists? I just need to be on playlists. It's cool if you get on some playlists, that's awesome. You're gonna get some streams and monthly listeners and make some money, and that's good. But don't fool yourself into thinking that those are your fans. Those are not fans. Those are monthly listeners. Those are listeners within Spotify who then like your music because it was on a playlist that they follow. That's not your goal. Your goal is to get fans. Now, how do you get fans and how do you get listeners on the internet, because that's where everybody is existing these days, without getting on playlists? Direct marketing. Now, what is direct marketing? Direct marketing, it's very simple. Finding your audience and inviting them into your world. That's all direct marketing is. I know as soon as I said marketing and direct marketing, half your eyes just glazed over and you're like, oh shit, he's about to start to talk about stuff that just makes my head spin right off. I get it. Don't worry, it's a very simple concept. All right, I want to talk about Lucidius. I mentioned him before. A guy with 500,000 monthly Spotify listeners, 100 million streams across all platforms, not just Spotify. He has a strong presence on Spotify, Apple Music, Pandora, Amazon. He has 250,000 Facebook likes, 100,000 Instagram followers. You know how many official Spotify playlists he's on? Zero. Zero. 500,000 monthly listeners. Guess what? No label, no manager. And he distributes through, I want to say, DistroKid. So he's got no rep pushing his shit. DistroKid does not push your music at the DSPs. They get you from A to B. Love those guys. But they're not like calling him up and be like, you gotta work this record. That's not their business model. No playlists. And he doesn't play live. He doesn't tour. Like, wait, what? How does he do this? Direct marketing. All direct marketing is targeting people that you think will be into your music. Targeting them through ads. Used to be Facebook ads were real hot, Instagram ads, those kind of ads, but you get really specific with how you target them. Facebook ads are not as effective anymore. Raise your hand if you've ever run a Facebook ad. Okay, half of you. And put your hand back up if you were less than thrilled with the results. Me too. Oh yeah. Facebook ads are not effective if you don't know how to run them and what you're doing. And now especially, they're way less effective because it's so saturated. Everybody's running ads on Facebook. you're looking at 45 cents a click. That's not sustainable. You can't bring people over there at that rate. So you have to find ways to utilize direct marketing. Instagram ads are actually becoming very effective right now. There are ways that you can use these platforms, but if you have to get very specific in how you're targeting your audience. Don't just say, don't ever boost a post. Don't ever click promote in Instagram. Don't use it that way. If you're gonna run ads on Instagram or you're gonna run ads on Facebook, you wanna go into the Facebook ad manager and you wanna master that and get really good at that and how that is utilized, because that's how you're gonna control everything. Facebook owns Instagram, they run that stuff. It's very easy to click boost and then say, damn, I just spent $25 and nothing happened, except I got a bunch of likes on Facebook. What does that even mean? Or I got a bunch of like plays on my Facebook video. Cool, I guess, I don't know. Is that good? Are those fans, or are they just like, did they watch your video for 4 seconds through their newsfeed? Probably. Same with Instagram. You don't wanna hit promote. Don't hit that button. That's like going to Vegas and putting all your money in slots and thinking like, man, I just lost a lot of money. By hitting promote or boost, that's like you're gambling your money away. It doesn't work. Don't hit that stuff. If you really want to run these ads effectively, you got to go into the business manager. And there's various ways that you can do this. This is how Lucidius did it. This is how a lot of artists are doing it these days, where they are going to find their audience where they exist online, whether it's going to be Facebook or Instagram ads or Google or YouTube ads or whatever kind of ads that you want to do. And you don't need to spend that much money. He spent $5 a day doing this stuff. The other thing is you want to target people that you think are going to be into your music. You target, FYI, this is going till 2. So I think they're leaving because they want to get to a session, but we're going a little bit. That's just how long our session is. Hopefully you're okay with that. Okay. You want to target your niche, not your haters. And I made this mistake very early on. Now, when I was performing around Minneapolis, around the Twin Cities in Minnesota, I was becoming very popular, specifically on like the University of Minnesota campus, and the Twin Cities at large. And I had, because I was becoming so popular and because I didn't figure out my story, I didn't know what my story was, I didn't think I needed a story, I didn't think I needed to tell my story. One was being written about me because of how popular I was becoming. And in the newspaper, the Minnesota Daily, which was distributed to it as an 80,000 person reach, the music editor of the Daily wasn't really feeling what I was putting out, writing their own story about me, because I didn't tell them the story, I didn't know, I was just playing music, building an audience. And the first piece he wrote on me, Herstand, her sucks. Clever. And then the second piece he wrote on me, it was in the freshman survival guide, handed out to all 10,000 incoming students at the University of Minnesota. You know, stuff to do around town. Here's the best restaurants you should go to. Here's the parts of the city you should visit. Here's the top three artists of Minnesota. You should definitely check out these bands. Top three worst artists. Worst bands in Minnesota? Number one worst band in Minnesota, R.E. Herstand. Avoid that motherfucker at all costs. That's a true story. And then the third article he wrote on me was in the December joke edition of the Minnesota Daily. I was on the cover.
I made the cover.
I was right next to the president of the university and Lindsay Lohan. And my headline, Surgeons Attempt to Reattach Local Musician's Balls. Fails. Thank you. Thank you. I have no balls. I get it. Okay. So, guess what? Guess what I did with those? I should have just ignored it and laughed it off, but I didn't. That shit hurt. And, you know, I was like, oh, shoot. Guess what? I bet Mr. Daly that you don't, you don't get my music. I know you probably only heard these last songs. Those songs are bad. That was my last album, and this album was just, you know, yeah, I was young, I didn't know what I was doing. You should hear this new music. This is the good stuff. You're gonna really like this music. No. No, I wasted so much time going after my haters saying, oh, but I bet I can convince you to like me. Nope. They're never going to like you because they didn't care about my music. That first article, Her Stand, Her Sucks, I saved it. Why? Because he didn't mention my music once. It was 7 paragraphs long. He talked about who he thought my fans were. He went into my personal Facebook profile and ripped my favorite movies. I'm dead serious. And I'm like, this is really interesting. He didn't even mention my music. So, wow. Okay, then there's a disconnect here. Why does he hate me so much? I thought I must have slept with his girlfriend or something like that. I'm like, what is the deal? Research? Did not. But what's going on? It's because a story was being written about me, and I didn't know that. I didn't get in front of my story. I didn't have a story. I didn't communicate my story effectively. So he thought that frat boys and sorority girls were into my music, and he didn't like that. He didn't like frat boys and sorority girls. So he's like, oh, so this guy's a douche, and only the Greek community's into him, blah, blah, blah. That wasn't true. He'd never been to one of my shows, but that's what he thought, because he probably was walking by frat row and heard somebody talk about my name a couple times, and it's like, you know? So you have to write your story. Same with the Dave Matthews Band, who we were talking about before, and I realized I didn't mention the name of that band. So for those of you who've been sitting and waiting and wondering who the band I was talking about, that Colin, did Colin leave? Dude! All right. You gotta tell me if you're gonna be my volunteer that you're gonna stick around and tuck him in. All right. So anyway, yeah, I know. Well, he failed this class. No participation points awarded. I've removed all of those participation points. That was the Dave Matthews Band earlier, who we were talking about. And the reason I use that example and not a more current example is because a lot of people, younger people these days don't know who they are, and so I don't think Colin probably knew who they were because he would have mentioned it. He was younger, and I like to use that because most people, they're not tainted by the story. But they did have a stigma. And for those of you who are old enough to remember, their stigma in the late 90s, early 2000s, was that they were first the band of hippies, and then they became the band of frat boys and sorority girls. And that was their stigma. And so, When I got to college, and I realized they actually weren't that cool to like. And I was reading all these blog articles about the 100 worst bands of all time, because bloggers have clearly nothing better to do with their time than shit on music. They topped every list. Dave Matthews Band, they would list as the worst band of all time on every list. I'm like, that's just factually incorrect. That is factually wrong. There are way, way worse bands. There are bands that don't have the musicianship of that. And I didn't get it. I was a musician. I was a guitar player. I'm like, nobody plays like Dave. I studied his songs. I'm like, this shit is complicated. This is crazy. Nobody plays like him. The drummer, one of the greatest living drummers of all time, nobody plays like Carter. And that his meticulous, his style and the groove that Colin mentioned, that style is perfectly balanced out with Leroy Moore's sax playing because he's much more soul, and Carter is straight ahead and meticulous. And that's balanced out by the fiddle that just carries everything, brings it together, and then Stefan is laid back in the pocket and he's just the less is more bassist over here. And I'm like, that's what I'm listening to. They're amazing. And lyrically, and the changes, and they're going all over the place, and I'm studying the music. None of those articles, 100 worst bands of all time, mention their music. And if they did, it was just like a side thought and they were just laughing about it or something. It was the story, the stigma that they had become. You have to tell your story, get out in front of that and help communicate, because then when you start to reach those levels of success, that's the story they're gonna tell. And if you don't communicate your story, one will be written about you. And if you do get haters, ignore them. That was my mistake, because I turned my back on my supporters by going after the haters, trying to change the kind of music I made to appease the haters. Rick Rubin, he said, the best art divides an audience. If you put out a record and half the people who hear it absolutely love it, and half the people who hear it absolutely hate it, you've done well. because it's pushing that boundary. If everyone thinks, that's pretty good, why bother making it? Thank you, guys.